were gentle words she had never heard before. He said, Lisa, listen to me. Don't you know where you belong? Darling Lisa, you can tell me you've been silent for too long. Once another man took her on a younger day. Never heard before. Ooh, well, she had never heard before. He said, Lisa, listen to me. Don't you know where you belong? Darling Lisa, you can tell me you've been silent for too long. A girl I knew, all alone and unprepared. Everyone she knew, running scared. Then she found him, maybe he found her. His were gentle words she had never heard before. Oh, no, no, she had never heard before.
Inflation has cost us dearly in the last year. One hidden cost is to our sense of freedom. Freedom in the marketplace, for one thing, some things we cannot get anymore, other things we cannot pay for anymore. Freedom of movement, too, limited by the cost of a new house, by the cost of gasoline. Even our freedom to dream, our normal expectations of getting ahead, are being reduced to hopes of holding on. Many of us are falling behind. This is a new strain of inflation, and it infects the whole world. It threatens our way of life, and it can threaten our form of government, as we will see in this broadcast.
CBS reports. Inflation. How much? How long?
Oh, Mom, you look so good. You never change.
Well, I come from pretty good stock.
You know that's no guarantee of keeping your health. That's why you were always after me to eat right, exercise,
and take Geritol to make sure you get enough iron and vitamins.
She wouldn't miss a day, and she wants me to take it, too.
And you should.
Because when you've got your health, you've got just about everything.
Geritol. More than twice the iron of any ordinary supplement, and some very important vitamins. Geritol every day. Remember the good old days when you could buy a brand new car at a reasonable price? You still can. Just get the lowest sticker-priced car sold in America, the Toyota Corolla 1200.
You sure have a neat car, Ricky.
See how much car your money can buy.
Here is CBS News correspondent John Hart.
To most of us, inflation is simple. It is the outrageous prices we are paying for nearly everything. But prices are only the sting at the end of the whip. To get to the handle, we have to ask some basic questions. Here they are. What is inflation? Is it bad? That's not as silly as it sounds. Some people benefit. What can be done about it? Why are we having this inflation? And what can be done about it? And the main question, will it go away? The first one is easy. Inflation is a time of rising prices. Wars have always brought inflation to this country. Here's what the cost of living has done throughout our history. It has always jumped fastest in a war, from the Revolution right through the Indochina War. The reason that war brings inflation is it has us making war machines instead of cars or houses, silk stockings or bubble gum. Almost everyone works during a war, so there's more money to spend but fewer things to buy. So the prices of what is for sale go up. The war in Indochina brought us inflation as high as 6% a year. That's where our troubles started. In that war, which the government tried to pay for without raising taxes nearly enough. And that's another reason war makes inflation. It costs so much, we never pay for it all at the time. But we can't blame all of our troubles now on that war. The war inflation went down to 3.5% in the early 70s. And what we have now, 12%, came on in peacetime in the first quarter of this year. Inflation is as old as money. Nero set off inflation in Rome by issuing a lot of coins made of cheap metal. Later, the emperor Diocletian tried wage and price controls, and the Romans rioted. In fact, many historians think inflation helped the Roman Empire to fall apart. The United States was started with an inflation. The Continental Congress printed up 250 million paper dollars to pay and equip General Washington's army. By the end of our revolution, the Continental dollar was a joke. Not worth a continental, people would say. In our lifetime, wild inflations have helped destroy entire political systems. Take Germany. World War I bankrupted Germany, and the victors demanded reparation payments in addition, even though the country was broke. So the German government printed money. And the mark hit Skid Row. Before the war in 1914, the mark had been worth four to a dollar. 9 years later, after the war and after defeat, it was worth $4 trillion to a dollar. You needed a cart of marks to go out for a loaf of bread. Inflation ended with currency reform, followed by a depression. German despair became a vehicle for Adolf Hitler's ride to power. After the Second World War, China had a runaway inflation. 400 million Chinese dollars were worth one American penny. As soon as people got money, they took it to a bank to try and exchange it for gold. A rickshaw ride cost bundles of money. And the chaos in China went on until the communists took control of everything. Of course, our worst inflation cannot compare with Germany's and China's. In a stable country, it takes monumental inflation to invite a political coup. But lesser inflation can bring harsh political change, particularly if it lasts a long time. So why even bother to ask, is inflation bad? Because the answer is it isn't always, if taken in moderation. Since World War II, our dollar has lost more than half its value, but that took over a quarter century. And in that time, most of us came to live far better than we did when the dollar was worth more. In fact, one of the reasons we have inflation is that we decided to never have another Great Depression after 1933. We proceeded to avoid depression by taking on mild and gradual inflation, trying to limit it to around 3% in peacetime. That was enough inflation to encourage business to grow, but not too fast, to create jobs and keep wages up. We figured then we could fine-tune our economy, and with gentle inflation spread some prosperity around. After all, 2 to 3% was so mild, we hardly noticed. Well, what can be done? What are the standard controls of inflation? Reducing demand, for one thing, we, the public, can do that on our own by not buying certain things. But we can't stop buying everything, so boycotts are selective, and their effect is selective. But the government can do lots of things. It can use fiscal policy. What that is tinkering with our taxes and government spending. Raising taxes cuts down on the money we have to spend and keeps us from buying so much. And when the government spends less, there's less money in circulation and fewer things are bought, too. The government can fiddle with monetary policy. That's Arthur Burns' job and the Federal Reserve Board's. They tell the government when to get into the market and buy or sell government bonds. and that influences the amount of money in use. In addition, the Fed can influence the amount of credit the banks have to offer and thereby influence spending that is based on credit. For such things as cars or houses or appliances, even business spending on such things as new equipment or factories. Controlling prices and wages is another thing the government can do and did. It worked for a while. Producing more things is a standard way of fighting inflation. The Agriculture Department told farmers to plant more acres, and now at the moment, food prices are not going up as fast as they were, and some have even gone down a little. So what got us into this fix? Where did this new strain of inflation come from? It used to be inflation and full employment went together. Not this time. Nearly 5 million people are out of work, unemployment more than 5%, and expected to rise. And we used to figure inflation came from the wage price spiral. Higher wages pushing up prices, making even higher wages necessary. You may think that's what happened this time, but in the last year, prices went up faster than wages, and economists agree wages aren't to blame in the current mess. But wages aren't controlled anymore, and labor may try to catch up and start up the old wage price push. It used to be inflation meant we'd produce a lot more, but this time our total production, what is called the gross national product, went down the first quarter of this year. And finally, inflation used to be more selective around the world, skipping from one country to another. This one is worldwide. Germany, with the biggest economy in Europe, has a 7.1% inflation. Japan, with the biggest economy in the Orient, has 23.9%. England has 15.2%. Canada, 9.9%. Yugoslavia is up to 19%. And Greece, 33.4%. Chile is over 700%, all in 12 months. The rest of the world has a big hand in our inflation of 12%. During all the years that we have been enjoying good growth and moderate inflation, the developing countries have been developing buying power and appetites for the things we've been enjoying all along. Not only that, but the world's food supply went down 2 years in a row. The Russian wheat deal gave us some inflation. When they had a bad crop in 1972, they bought our surplus. The thing is, our surplus had been a stable influence on world food prices just by being there. Now, it isn't there. Something happened to the anchovies of Peru, and that matters because after they became fish meal, they were an important source of protein for cattle feed. But the anchovies disappeared when the Humboldt current changed directions, so we had to feed our cattle other kinds of proteins, whose prices then went up. We can cheer up, though. The anchovies are coming back. The Arabs quadrupled the price of oil. That alone gave us as much as 3% inflation by some estimates, and that used to be our limit for inflation from everything. For the first time in memory, all the industrial countries of the world started expanding production at the same time, competing for raw materials and products. And all the time, people were producing more people, 200,000 new people a day, especially in the poorer countries. The dollar had been devalued, not once but twice, and that made our products cheaper. So foreigners began to compete with us in buying our own goods. Some economists feel that the government printed too much money to pay its bills in paper, and that that's what caused inflation. These are just a few things that happened, certainly not all. But what can be done? Well, one cure is a Great Depression, and some analysts say if we keep going this way, we'll have one like the bad one of the 1930s. That is one kind of cure that is worse than the disease. We can work it so we have small depressions and call them recessions. Some economists say our unemployment lines mean we are in a recession now, and it isn't working. In addition, the government can manipulate the money supply and federal spending in small steps and hope that over several years inflation will be squeezed to size. One scheme for spreading out the effect of inflation is indexing, tying everything to the changing cost of living. all wages, all taxes, all interest, everything. When Brazil did that, its inflation rate went from over 90% to around 15%. Of course, Brazil is a different kind of country from ours. It is a dictatorship with the power to control totally. Finally, will this inflation go on or will it go away? It is quite possible that without depression, we'll have inflation for the rest of this century and high inflation for several years. It is possible also that this year sometime inflation may go down below 10%. But the old 2 or 3% which we used to worry about and would now dearly love to have again is gone for a long time. At the end of this broadcast, we're going to ask the Nixon administration to tell us what it plans to do about that. Incidentally, we're not going to hear from any economists tonight because, frankly, that would be confusing. We consulted a number of them in preparing this broadcast and found that the main thing they agree on is that they disagree on this inflation. We're going to see the people whose job is not to generalize, but to survive this inflation. They are ordinary people along the chain of rising prices who have some good ideas about where the money is going. That when we come back.
I'm so glad you called, honey.
I just had to tell you what a wonderful time we had, Mama.
Well, we loved having you both.
And Mama, I want to thank you for telling Tom about Sominex. It really helped him.
Well, Sominex does help when you sometimes have trouble falling asleep.
Did just like you said. Helped make him drowsy so he could get to sleep.
With a lot less trouble thanks to you.
Oh, Tom, thanks to Sominex.
Sominex. It helps take the trouble out of falling asleep.
Here's the gas-saving Austin Marina with rack and pinion steering like our Jaguar, disc brakes like our Triumph, bulldog toughness like our Land Rover, and a single carburetor MGB engine, good for over 20 miles per gallon, based on Environmental Protection Agency tests, and proven reliable in over 2 billion miles of driving. The Austin Marina, $28.99, the tough economy car from British Leyland at your Austin dealer.
Pepsi's got just one calorie. We've got your number, it's one calorie, 'cause it's all sugar free. We got your number, it's one, a can full of taste but just one calorie. We got your number, it's one, it's got the taste 'cause it got it from Pepsi. We got your number, it's
Are you getting burned by your present homeowner's insurance? Are your claims settled quickly with courteous personal service? Are you paying for the wrong coverage? You better find out. See your independent insurance agent. He's on your side. He'll select a policy for a number of insurance companies. That way, you'll get just the protection you need at a fair cost. Get this free booklet from your professional independent insurance agent wherever you see this symbol.
For some reason, there's a myth that the soul of this country is somewhere in its center, where the typical American has grown up marching to the music of This Is My Country, where the earth is black and generous, and where traffic jams are scheduled by the trainmaster and nobody minds. Nice people who think their nice town is what America ought to be. This is Cedar Rapids, Iowa. The fact is, of course, the soul of the country is not in custody here, and there is no typical American. But we did find in Cedar Rapids some people who have common needs and common problems with the rest of the country in this mean inflation. Their name is Wishmeyer. Wendy is the oldest of the four kids. She's 16 and just finished the 10th grade at Thomas Jefferson High School. She helps out by making her own spending money after school at the Burger King. Tracy is 14. She likes to sew and that helps a lot on the cost of clothes. Scott is 7. He likes to help his dad, who does all the maintenance on the house himself. Kirk is 1. He likes to eat. Mrs. Wishmeyer, Patty, doesn't buy canned baby food anymore. She saves money by taking part of the regular family meal and putting it in the blender for Kirk. Harold Wishmeyer is a machinist at the Square D Circuit Breaker Company. His pay is about average for middle-income Americans, around $11,200 a year. Dollars that are shrinking these days at a rate of 10% a year. He's putting a bathroom in the basement himself. He repairs the 2 cars himself. In fact, he built the garage himself. He is so frugal and so handy, he is probably an untypical American that way. But inflation is hurting him just the same. In the last 12 months, his living costs went up 9.5%. His income only 5.5%. But we're not here to tell you his troubles. Nearly everybody has them. We're going to trace them back along the chain of prices and try to find out at every stage why they went up and who is getting the money from inflation. Food went up more than anything in Cedar Rapids, up more than 16% in the 12 months ending this April.
The prices have gone completely way, way up. What you buy each week, you think you're buying the same thing, and each time you go, it costs you more and more.
The family pack chicken, it's a larger sized chicken. You know, they put like 17 pieces of chicken in there for the bigger sized families. And it was 39 cents a pound last week, and this week it's up to 43 cents. I buy the large size of Western dressing, salad dressing for the salads, and that was $1.35, and it's $1.39 now.
So we went to Ron Pearson, the district manager of the Hy-Vee food stores, and asked him why Mrs. Wishmeyer had to pay 4 cents more for salad dressing this week.
I can't tell you exactly why this particular salad dressing went up. It would have to go back to the manufacturer. I can give you a little bit of background as to why several commodities have gone up. If we look at the short-run causes, I think that we might have to possibly look at you and I as probably part of the problems as a consuming public. In 1950, we were consuming about 55 pounds of beef per individual in the United States. Today, we're looking at well over 120 pounds of beef. Well, with the population increasing also 57% during that period of time, that's caused quite a demand for these type of items. So then, to go along with the short-run causes of inflation that's pushed these things up, there's been a crop failure. You're in the rice crop in Asia, 4% decrease last year. The disappearance of anchovies off the coast of Peru. That doesn't sound like a big factor to us, but again, they have to substitute their diet with some of the commodities that we would normally use. And of course, probably the biggest cause would be on the short run that we feel is the entrance of the Soviet Union into our wheat market, picking up several billion tons of wheat and pulling out of our economy.
Why did the family pack chicken go up 4 cents in a week?
Chickens are raised within about a 6 to 8 week cycle. So if the demand happens to be heavy at a particular time, then chicken prices can go up. But also a big cause in that is the feed price that goes into these chickens.
Patty Wishmeyer used to buy fresh bread from Lester Sikora's bakery. Now she buys day-old bread, several loaves at a time, and freezes them.
How much more do you charge for bread and rolls now than you did, say, a year ago?
Oh, a year ago? 25% more, I imagine. Be
Why?
Pretty close.
Why?
Because of the high cost of the ingredients, flour and sugar and lard.
For example, how much did your ingredients go up?
Oh, by the bag or by the pound, flour has went up from $9.70. Some of them went up as high as $21. Sugar has went up from 12 to about 28. Lard went up from, lard and shortening, from 22 cents to 45, 50. And everything has went up the same. I mean, Seeds have went up high. Caraway seed went from 90 cents to around 275 a pound.
Well, your flour has gone down a little bit lately. Are you going to lower your prices?
Oh, well, can't hardly do that because it's probably going to go right back up again, and then we're just, if it keeps on going down, we're just going to make up for what we've lost in the last 6 months.
That's what a lot of people in business seem to be doing, trying to make up for past losses. Dan McFarland, who raises breeding cattle in Iowa, says cattlemen may have ripped off the country for a while, along with a lot of other businessmen, but now they're getting caught by costs and shortages.
Fertilizer more than doubled in a year's time, where we paid $67 last year a ton for fertilizer. This year we had to pay $140 a ton, if you could get it. And I ordered mine last September in order to get it, and then they just says, well, we'll see if we can get you some. And it's not a case of going and shopping and say, decide whether I want to buy your fertilizer or not. You just go into the fellow that used to sell it to you and say, will you give me some? And
at whatever price.
Right. And he says, well, I have no, well, I bought my, ordered mine in September at $99 a ton. And when I received it in April, it was $144 a ton.
So what happened to fertilizer? Bill Plant asked a fertilizer man, Joseph Sullivan, president of Estec Corporation.
The prices of fertilizer have virtually doubled. Specifically, our latest estimates indicate an increase of about 85% over a year ago. Then as we ran into the severe weather problems of the early 70s, the greatly increased demand for protein around the world, prices, demand for fertilizer and prices for fertilizer began to move ahead considerably, and this last year has been unprecedented, really, in terms of world pricing for fertilizer and world demand for fertilizer.
Who gets the increased profit?
In terms of profits, it is our estimate that the industry in the United States alone is going to need approximately $1.5 billion to catch up with world demand by 1978 or 1979. And all of this money, and probably then some, is going to have to be plowed back. All of the profits are going to have to be plowed back into the industry to be able to take care of this increased capacity requirement.
The cost of housing went up over 8% in Cedar Rapids last year. Harold Wischmeyer escaped some of that. His utility bills went up, but he bought his house 15 years ago. He figures the cost of a house has doubled in that time, and he can't see how anyone can buy one these days.
I think I have a nice-looking house, but and it's a well-built house. But the guys that, the young guys that I work with, I don't see how they're ever going to have anything. You take, we had a $14,000 note on the house when we moved in. Okay, today, to buy a house compared to this, that the builders are putting up is $25,000 to $30,000. And that means these guys I'm working with, in order to get down to a $15,000 note, are going to have $10,000 cash money, and there's no place they're going to get it. No way.
Howard McLaughlin is sales manager for Skogman Homes, the big developer in Cedar Rapids. We asked him what happened to housing.
The costs of the house have gone up faster than the income. And anybody that thinks that they're going to wait until they can afford the house, by the time, at least this is the history has been in the past few years, by the time they could afford the house, what it was when they went out to see it, now can no longer afford it because the price has increased again.
The house we're in now, how much did you sell it for a year ago?
It was somewhere in the neighborhood of $27,000.
And today?
It's about 31, between 30 and 31.
Well, who's making the money from these higher prices? Are you?
Not ours. Our income shrinks constantly as the prices increase because we start a house today, but the price of the house, when we get through, the price of the materials will have increased.
Al Knapp at the Cedar Rapids Lumber Company knows about materials.
What's gone up in the last year?
Well, primarily roofing, anything in the roofing line.
Anything that has asphalt in it,
oil base
has gone up tremendously, probably 50%. Anything that's made of steel, aluminum, hardware, nails, they've gone up probably 25 to 30%.
You making more money this year than last?
No, we're not making any more. We're just handling more money.
Making the money in all this inflation?
I don't know. I don't have any idea who's making it. We're not.
We did find somebody who's getting some of it. Ron Nelson, electrical contractor.
We're living a lot better than we've ever lived. And if this is all bad, then there ought to be more of the bad part, as far as I'm concerned. Because there's too many good things that are going on right now for everybody to think solely, you know, of the bad points.
Well, is it good because of inflation or in spite of it?
I think it's good in spite of it. Inflation's there, but the thing is, you know, we have to either live with it or try to do something about it, and I don't think they're ever going to do anything about it. A lot of our material has gone up almost 200% in the last 12 months.
Well, who's getting that extra money?
Well, evidently, it's not the suppliers. It goes right back down the line. We're receiving letters from the manufacturers, Anaconda and some of the world's biggest manufacturers, who are wanting to buy scrap copper from us so they can remill it and put it back in circulation.
I talked to a rancher this week, cattleman, who said a lot of people are ripping a lot of people off. He said even the cattlemen did there for a while. What do you think?
I think this is true. I don't think there's that many saints in the world that this isn't going to happen. You know, it's going to happen.
Most houses are financed by savings and loan associations. The money they loan is from other people's savings. People are taking their money out of savings these days, leaving less money to lend on houses. In addition, Theodor Kubitschek, president of Bohemian Savings and Loan, is worried that higher interest rates these days are not helping.
Now, higher interest rates are supposed to hold down inflation, right? Generally speaking.
Well, this is the theory that Arthur Burns is using, chairman of the Federal Reserve Board. He has only one weapon, and that is to raise the cost of money to the commercial banks. And he's doing this, but it isn't so far seemingly doing too much good because businesses who borrow from banks feel that the rate is still cheaper than the inflation rate. And so if they pay 11 or 12%, whatever it is, for borrowed money, they figure that's cheaper than 14% inflation.
Dwayne Arnold of Iowa Electric says everything he uses went up, including interest.
Now, when we borrow money, we're competing with Montgomery Ward, Sears Roebuck, all of the very exotic companies, you know, that are growing very rapidly. And when we compete with them, we're in a tough marketplace. In addition to that, when the government's out here paying 9% for money on short-term notes, why in the world would you, as an investor, be willing to put money in our enterprise for anything less? Now, a few years ago, we were borrowing money for 3%, 2.75%, and 4%. Today, we're paying on a short-term loan, when you consider your compensating balance, we're paying 13% to borrow money.
What items did you use have gone up in the last year, and by how much?
Oh, in the last year, everything has gone up in the last year. I would say it ranges from a conductor in the area of 32%. Our coal costs in the last year have increased about 45 to 48%.
Why have they gone up? Who's getting that money?
Well, I presume the coal miners are, or the coal mine owners and the coal miners themselves.
The man Arnold buys coal from is John Sense of Trivoli, Illinois. He talked to Bill Plant.
Mr. Sense, how much has the price of coal increased in the last year?
Oh, approximately 35, 40%.
Why?
A number of reasons, Bill. The Labor costs, of course, have risen by labor agreement. I think figure there is probably 17.5%. The health and welfare benefits have increased considerably over the last several years. Workmen's compensation has increased tremendously. And then the reclamation charges are much higher than they were a few years back.
Are profits up?
No. Unfortunately, profits compress under a situation like that. We're dealing basically with long-term contracts, and they were negotiated in 1965, for instance, and you had a 15% profit margin on $3.50 coal. Everything escalates except the profit margin, so where you had possibly a 20-cent profit in 1965, we now have a 20-cent profit, and we're talking about $8 or $9 coal.
Now you know why the Wishmeyer's electric bill went up. Clothing went up almost 7% in Cedar Rapids, and Patty and her daughters are making some of their own clothes.
We make a lot of our clothes, dresses and pantsuits and stuff like that. What they can't handle, I always try and make for them.
But you can't make shoes or suits for Sunday or things like that.
Just buy one good pair of shoes and buy them one good pair of shoes when they go to school in the fall and say, you got to wear them all year and take care of them.
Take care of them.
Patty Wishmeyer says she doesn't want the kids to look like discount kids, so she stays away from the discount stores and waits for sales at Armstrong's, the department store, where Alan Peremski is manager.
The inflationary factor of clothing for 1973 was about 6.4%, which, as you know, is far less than the national average. We have been confronted with shortages, I think, in many of the areas, which maybe has also contributed to the inflationary factor. Wools have been very difficult. Cottons are becoming almost impossible, and we've had trouble in the polyester areas. Well, I think that, as it's been stated by the media, that a lot of foreign countries are coming in and purchasing large quantities of this material from fabricators here in the United States.
What items in your store have gone up most during this inflationary year?
Well, I think in 73, the items that increased the most were leather items, shoes, handbags, this type of thing, but primarily in the footwear area.
Patty paid $12 for Kirk's baby shoes at Ford's shoe store. Babies outgrow their shoes about every 3 months, and that's close to $50 a year for baby shoes. And the price goes up 5 to 10% a year. We went to the shoe store and asked Robert Tibbetts, the owner, why.
Why does it keep going up? Who's getting the money year after year as these go up?
Well, I think
5 to 10%.
I think everybody involved gets their share of it.
Why did leather go up?
Well, the tanners raised their prices because of labor. There's been some talk in this area where there's a lot of farm people and they sell their hides. They say they're not getting any more money for their hides. But the people that manufacture the shoes, they have to pay more. And if you follow the markets and look at your leather prices, the last year has been fairly stable, but for a year and a half to 2 years prior, there was some leathers that doubled, tripled in prices. But those prices were handed off to the shoe manufacturer, and they had to pass them on to us. So.
And you have to pass them on to the buyer.
Right.
Hey, that looks like a pretty good fit.
Not only baby shoes, jeans went up over 30%. Cotton is short, for one thing, because foreign countries like Japan bought so much from us. More than 19% of all of our cotton last year alone. Tony Sargent went to cotton farmer Marshall Lord in Dudley, Georgia.
In 73, when the world demand and shot prices up to 80 and 90 cents, this really threw things out of kilter. Farmers hadn't enjoyed the benefits of these higher prices, and consumers have had to pay, or now, just now beginning to pay the price in high apparel cost. Now, this is, I'm a consumer, and I think my wife just went out and bought me some shirts the other day, and I can't believe what they cost. But I can't believe I sold my cotton for 32 cents last year, and see apparel prices where they are this year.
Marshall, prices on clothing are so much higher. You say you're not making a great deal more money than you were. Who along the line between you and the consumer is making it, do you reckon?
This is hard to say that any one person is making it. Last year when I contracted my cotton, maybe the man that bought it sold it to the mill, maybe he held it and didn't sell it at the high price. I'm not saying he made a tremendous profit on it. I don't want to put my finger on any one end of any one place in the economy.
Back in Cedar Rapids, the cost of getting around went up almost 11%, cars themselves and gasoline and repairs. Harold Wischmeyer does his own repairs, but the cost of gasoline is threatening his vacation to Disney World this summer, and so's the cost of tires.
Oh, tires. I have to buy a set of tires before we can take the trip, and I went and priced tires to go. I told her, I said, well, we'll get a good set of tires, and tires for that car are $150 for just the plain. I wanted to get radial tires, but at $55 and $60 a tire, I can't put radial tires on it. I figured if I bought one set of radial tires the way they've been bragging about them, I'd never have to buy another set of tires for the car. But I can't plunk out $200-$300 at one time. If I do that, we won't take
the trip.
Stay home. The price the working man, I feel, out of everything that could be nice or a luxury to him, like the vacations, they've almost priced me out of that. They've put me out of the price, priced me out of buying a car, because when you have to go downtown and pay $5,000 to $6,000 for a Chevy or a Ford or a Plymouth, which I kind of think is a car that a guy like me should be able to purchase and drive without any trouble, there's something wrong.
Downtown, Bill Fletcher manages Rapid Chevrolet. He figures Harold is right.
We sell Chevrolets, and that's supposedly in the low price market, and we've got cars that'll sell for $6,000. And a lot of people can't afford a $6,000 car. So in the used car market, we're just selling more used cars in proportion to our new cars than we ever did before.
Where have your costs gone up?
Well, I think the biggest cost that affects a car dealer is the cost to floor plan your inventory of cars. That's the money we borrow to keep cars in inventory. But the cost of the money that we borrow has gone way up. And every day, our money is tied basically to prime rate. And so I know that the car that used to cost me for interest maybe $1, $2 to keep in stock a day, now might be $5, $6.
The higher cost of transportation is mainly gasoline. Roy Caron of WMT-TV went to Richard Bartell's filling station in Cedar Rapids to see if he was making the money on gas prices. He said no, the oil companies are charging him more.
Do you think they have a right to raise the price of gasoline?
Yes, I do, because gas is not raised in accordance with other items, and it's not as high. You take off the 11 cents state and federal tax, and that brings you down to 46 cents a gallon. Almost any item you would find in a store, you aren't going to get for 46 cents a gallon.
The man in charge of prices for Amoco is Terry Redmond. He talked to Ike Pappas.
How much more is a driver paying today for your gasoline than he did a year ago?
Well, in Chicago, he's paying about 59 cents a gallon on average, and a year ago, he was paying about 41 cents a gallon.
Why has the price gone up?
Foreign oil, basically the big Middle East producing countries, Venezuela, Canada. Canada has increased its price of oil export to the United States via an excise tax.
What percentage did the company profits increase over last year?
Well, our earnings last year for Standard of Indiana, which is our parent company, were up 36% from 72.
And where are these profits going?
Going right back into exploration. We're going to spend $1.4 billion this year, of which $1 billion is for oil exploration.
Medical inflation wasn't as bad in Cedar Rapids as food or housing or transportation, 6.2%, but it was bad for the Wischmeyers. Both Harold and Patty had to go to the hospital for minor surgery.
If you have to go to the hospital and you're there very long, you better have some savings, or else you're gonna be in trouble. Hospital costs have gone up so bad that you almost can't afford to go. For 3 years in a row, I've had medical bills that I've paid out over $1,000 a year for the past 3 years, over and above what our insurance paid.
Okay, that's good.
Patty Wishmeyer's doctor is William Galbraith. He's charging her more, but says he's not making more.
Actually, in the last 3 years, since August of 71, our fees have gone up $1 for an office visit from $10 to $11.
What things in your office and the cost of delivering medical care have gone up in the last year?
Electrocardiogram paper. The 24 rolls of this has now started to cost us $60. $11 increase in 6 months. An ampule of a chemical that we use in treating cancer has increased in the last year by $1, so that it's now $4.70 an ampule. We have to transfer that onto the patient, of course. I'm not taking home any more money now than I did, say, in 1968. The amount of money I take home is the same.
The Wishmeyers went to Mercy Hospital, where Sister Mary Halligan is administrator. She said, sure, her charges went up, but the hospital didn't get the money.
Equipment, hospital equipment is just almost out of sight, but I guess I could leave that out and go to the things that are absolutely necessary for the operation of patient care. And one of the areas that I think is absolutely essential are towels and washcloths. And that has increased 91% since January of 1973 to 1974.
91%.
91% increase in the cost of that. Food costs are very much increased. Meat, and when I speak about meat, I'm thinking mostly of the beef, because that's the area that I sort of think that we serve the most of. That's gone up about 53%. And sugar has gone up 138% since last January. Oil, cooking oil, of which we use a great deal, has gone up 53%.
Have you figured out where this money's going, why these prices have gone up?
I would say that probably the thing that nationwide is the reason for increased costs is probably manpower.
Well, who gets the money from the sugar that went up over 100%, 130%?
I couldn't answer that question, but it's certainly not the laborers in the sugar fields.
How does it look for the future? I mean, where are we going?
I see that nothing except increases. I would hate to say what I say. I don't want to say. But I really think that the American people, being an affluent society, and have gotten so used to affluence, maybe that the only thing that's going to bring us back to reality is a depression. And it looks to me like inflation has gone to the point that a depression is possible.
What we found in Cedar Rapids was that everyone is handling more money these days, but few admit to making more. But there are some winners in this inflation, which we found by reading financial statements. The big grain dealers, for example, as CBS reports noted 3 weeks ago. Profits for one of them, Cook Industries, were up 300%. The meat packers had a record year in 1973, even with the boycott. Profits were up an average 53%. The big food chains made 34% more profit last year than the year before, and they are doing even better this year. First quarter profits up 59% over the same quarter last year. Farmers' income went up 33% last year, so some farmers made money. How much, depending on their own costs. Real estate and housing profits were up 47%. Steel, 43%. Chemicals, 41%. Textiles and clothing, 17%. And of course, the Arabs in oil are making $60 billion more this year than last. A lot of speculators made a lot of money if they bought smart in land, wheat, cotton, corn, copper, sugar, silver, antiques, old coins, good art. People with big inventories made out well, big inventories of nearly anything. And people who were paying off old debts benefited too by paying in cheaper dollars on older and lower interest rates. The losers were a lot of the rest of us, consumers in general. Middle-income families are spending 20 to 30% of their income on food alone these days. And poor people, of whom there are 25 million in this country, are spending as much as half of their small income on food of the lowest quality. Despite what seems to be a general belief to the contrary, labor did not get ahead of this inflation, wages up only 7.1% in the 12 months ending in April, as the cost of living went up 10.2%. And a lot of people who went into the stock market to keep up with inflation went behind. What the government intends to do about all this when we come back.
How much for gas? You know, with the high cost of driving today, you need all the help you can get. To stretch your gas mileage, get a Lee two-stage maxi air filter. Air filters waste gas as they get dirty and choke off air. But Lee saves gas because it has a second stage to stay cleaner longer. You save even more because you do it yourself with these tools.
The Lee two-stage maxi air filter at discount chain and auto stores. If you want more for your money these days.
Do it yourself with Lee.
Could you junk your present auto insurance? Are your claims settled quickly with courteous personal service? Are you paying good money for the wrong coverage? You better find out. See your independent insurance agent. He's on your side. He'll select a policy from a number of insurance companies. That way, you'll get just the protection you need at a fair cost. Get this free booklet from your professional independent insurance agent wherever you see this symbol.
You are about to witness a crime. An unsuspecting traveler, her wallet buried safely in a canvas bag. Watch closely. Don't carry cash. Carry American Express traveler's checks. Now, there are other brands of traveler's checks, but they're not the same. Only American Express can give you emergency refunds 365 days a year. So insist on American Express traveler's checks.
Feeling free and rolling easy. You got places to be going. Leaving troubles miles behind you. You can keep a smile inside you. Freedom's just another word for Datsun. Cause Datsun sings.
Set you free.
Datsun sings.
Got down, set you free.
The American economy is so complicated and is so welded to the rest of the world's complicated economies that economists generally agree the burden of stopping inflation is on the government. The president's economic counselor is Kenneth Rush. George Herman asked him what the administration is going to do.
Well, the basic causes of inflation today have been, more than anything else, the fuel situation and the food situation. As you know, the price of oil, which has quadrupled, came about from basically a political, military situation in the Middle East, with hostilities in the Middle East. In meeting that problem, we are encouraging in every way possible the finding of more oil. The Alaska pipeline is being constructed. Conversions from oil to coal by public utilities is going forward and is being pressed. A bill to try to increase strip mining without too much damage to the environment is going forward. In order to meet the food situation, we have put back into production some 60 million acres of idle land, and are otherwise encouraging the maximum growth of food. We have removed import quotas on beef and other meats from overseas, and are trying to keep food prices, therefore, from rising further. And in some cases, as you know, they have been declining quite substantially. The tight money policy of the Federal Reserve Bank is having, I think, a very excellent effect and is a good policy. With regard to our fiscal management, we're now reviewing the budget to see to what degree we can affect cuts in the 1975 budget. We are pushing toward the objective of trying to have a balanced budget for 1976. And we are attempting to prevent the introduction of bold new social programs that cost a lot of money and that will feed inflation today. Many good programs which otherwise might be favored should not be put into effect at this time when inflation is such a very grave danger to our economy.
You talked of the inflation rate for the rest of the economy, leaving out fuel and food, as being about 6.3%. How would you characterize that?
Well, that is higher than I would like to see it.
A lot higher?
Yes, I would hope that we can get back to the 3% that or less that we have had during much of our history.
So what the administration is going to do is what it has been doing, and not much more. We've been pursuing the subject of inflation for several weeks now in preparing for this broadcast, and it's been a good deal like hunting the snark. The snark, you recall, was the creature of Lewis Carroll's poem of the same name that defied everyone's grasp. And what Carroll said about the snark hunters is a satisfying description of the experts in recent days trying to get a hold on inflation. They sought it with thimbles, they sought it with care. They pursued it with forks and hope. They threatened its life with a railway share. They charmed it with smiles and soap. Well, we've tried care and hope, and goodness knows we've had plenty of smiles and soap, and this inflation will not be charmed. It is costing us 12% a year at the moment. That's how much. And even if it goes down to 9 or 8 or 7 by the end of the year, that will be double or triple what we used to think was normal. And that depends on labor holding back from trying to catch up. How long? Who knows? Everyone agrees that high inflation is likely for years, maybe decades. We may have to change our minds about it and simply accept high inflation and unemployment as normal in a new world. We may have to give up the old American expectation of getting ahead all the time and go back to working for the necessities. We have already, as we said, given up certain freedoms in the marketplace. And if this inflation goes on as it is, we may lose more fundamental freedoms. Arthur Burns, chairman of the Federal Reserve Board, said last month, we are in danger.
If past experience is any guide, the future of our country is in jeopardy. No country that I know of has been able to maintain widespread economic prosperity once inflation got out of hand. And the unhappy consequences are by no means solely of an economic character. If long continued, inflation at anything like the present rate would threaten the very foundations of our society.
Long and high inflation robs livelihood of its worth and people of their hope. When hopeless people become desperate, they are open to radical change. In China, it was a communist revolution. In Germany, a fascist dictatorship. In this country, Arthur Burns is warning it could be an end to the private enterprise system. Burns was heard for a day and then somehow forgotten in the political and diplomatic events that have followed. But if Burns were chairman of the Joint Chiefs, warning of a threat from the outside, instead of chairman of the Federal Reserve Board, warning of this threat from within, he would not be so easily ignored. I'm John Hart. Good night.
With all due modesty, we at Lancers believe we have the finest rosé wine in the world. We also have a superb white. In fact, until recently, only one thing was missing, a red. But now Lancers proudly introduces Rubio, a full-bodied ruby red wine. Try new Rubio. It's not just another red wine. It's another Lancers.
New Rubio, the red Lancers.
Now, from the maker of America's number one selling compact cars comes a new small car. Valiant, chrome, economically small for good gas mileage, yet luxurious. With elegant features like richly textured crushed velour seats, deep shag carpeting, elegantly appointed in the style of a fine European sedan, at an American compact price. Valiant Brougham, one of eight great small car buys from Plymouth.
This has been CBS Reports. Inflation, how much, how long? With correspondent John Hart. The CBS Friday Night Movie will return next week at 9 o'clock on most of these stations.